Hello and welcome to MCoding. Today we're talking about extending Python's built-in number system. We'll walk through a class that I've written that implements infinite precision complex numbers. More specifically, this implementation models what are called the Gaussian rationals. These are just complex numbers where both the real and imaginary parts are rational. As it turns out, implementing your own number type is in some ways easier and in some ways harder than you might expect. Python provides a lot of machinery to help you do it, but there are also quite a few gotchas. In particular, making sure this class works with other existing number types like integers is a bit tricky. So let's dive in. The first issue we run into is what to even call this class. Calling it a fraction is somewhat misleading. Any number can be written as a fraction. Pi, for instance, which is irrational, can be written as pi divided by 1, which is a fraction. But Python already has a built-in fraction type, which represents rational numbers, not fractions. So we'll steam ahead and call a complex fraction, but be aware, naming is hard. The next thing to be aware of is that Python already has a hierarchy of abstract base classes that represent different systems of numbers. They're number, complex, real, rational, and integral, with number being the base class of all number types, even those that may represent things outside of the complex numbers, like quaternions. Each of the others just add on some operations, like complex numbers need to be able to convert to the built-in complex, and they need to have real and imaginary parts. And they also tell you that you need to implement things like addition and subtraction. The one that makes the most sense for us is to inherit from complex. There is also rational, but that's not a good fit for our class. Internally, our complex fraction is just going to store two fractions, the real and imaginary parts. We don't want to allow storing any other attributes onto our class. So we force the real and imaginary parts are the only two things we can assign to using slots. This will also make our complex fractions use less memory. Next, note that we're using new here, not init. That's because, like all other built-in number types, we want our complex fraction to be immutable. Whenever you define a class that's immutable, you have to use new instead of init, because although it would be uncommon, init is allowed to be called on the same object multiple times. If init was the place that the real and imaginary parts were set, then that could potentially mutate an existing object, which isn't allowed. Now, of course, this is Python, so there is no such thing as true immutability. If someone really wanted to, they could reach in and change this underscore attribute. But in Python, it's sort of an unspoken rule that if you have an attribute starting with an underscore, it's an implementation detail that shouldn't be accessed by the outside world. To give the outside world access to our real and imaginary parts, we just use properties. These properties allow anyone to read the real or imaginary part like an attribute, but if they try to assign to it, they'd get an error. Also notice this little symbol on the left of my editor. This tells you that I'm overriding something in a base class. In this case, the real and imaginary properties are required by our complex base class. Next up, we have factories and conversion functions. It's really up to you to decide what kind of convenience functions that you want to give your users. Currently, our new function takes the real and imaginary parts. We pass each part into the built-in fraction class. This means we're automatically supporting anything that the built-in fraction does. In particular, we can handle rationals, floats, strings, and decimals. However, this doesn't cover all of the cases. For instance, we might like to be able to construct a complex fraction from a built-in complex number or from a string that contains both the real and imaginary parts. So feel free to create whatever factories you think would be useful. And sometimes your users don't necessarily want to deal with your class. In this case, they might prefer to just have a tuple of the real and imaginary part. And it's also good practice to give them a way to convert to the built-in complex type. This is also something that's required for our base class. Of course, define a nice string and repr function, and then we get to the interesting arithmetic operations. Addition, subtraction, and so on. And here's where the first big gotcha comes in. Why did I define this underscore add method instead of just making this the implementation of the double underscore add method? If you're not familiar with these double underscore or dunder methods, they're Python's way of allowing you to define for your own classes what things like plus, times, divide mean. So if I have two complex fractions, then x plus y, we'll call this dunder add with x and y as arguments. And if we put our implementation in the dunder add and set our add to none, then our example appears to work. 1 plus 2i plus 3 plus 4i gives 4 plus 6i. But if you add a complex fraction to, say, a built-in complex type, then you might get an unexpected answer. What happened here is this 1.2 got converted into this crazy ratio of integers. Now, maybe that is what you expected to happen, but what a lot of people would expect to happen, and what's in line with how some of the other built-in number types work, you might expect Python to recognize that the y here isn't a complex fraction, so we should no longer try to be maintaining this infinite precision, and instead just convert our complex fraction to a normal complex and do the addition there. This makes the result type a plain old complex number, and the result is much more readable. And there's a subtle other issue lurking here. Suppose we take 1 plus 2i plus 1. Integers in Python are exact, so we're happy to keep the answer as another complex fraction. But if instead of x plus y, we do y plus x, now we get an error. When x was on the left-hand side, we were calling the complex fractions add method. But when y is on the left-hand side, we're calling the add method of the built-in int. The built-in int does not know how to add itself to our complex fraction, resulting in the error. And this is the purpose of rAdd. rAdd is supposed to do the same thing as add, but with the arguments in the reverse order. If the built-in int indicates that it doesn't know how to add itself to the other object, Python will then go to the other object and ask itself if it knows how to reverse add itself to the int. So add gets called when self is on the left-hand side, and rAdd gets called if it can't use others add and self is on the right-hand side. The implementation, though, is exactly the same as the other add, just with the arguments swapped. In this case, addition is commutative, so we didn't have to swap them, but in general, like if you were implementing division, then swapping them is the right thing to do. Now we'd like to solve both of our problems at the same time. We have repeated code that's in need of a shared implementation, and we want to implement this behavior of falling back to floating point arithmetic if we can't do exact operations. So we introduce our underscore add method. We can now implement the add and rAdd methods in terms of the underscore add, just adding self other versus adding other self. Then we need to add the fallback logic into both methods. Now, if we just had add and rAdd, we might just do that manually. But because we're going to need to do this logic for plus, minus, times, divide, and any other arithmetic operations that you would need, instead we're going to define a function which generates both of those functions for us. And that's what this operator fallbacks does. It takes in the operation that we want to do in the case that we can handle everything in infinite precision, and it also takes in the operation that we want to do if it has to fall back to floating point arithmetic. In this case, we're just using operator.add, which is the built-in add operation. So how does this operator fallbacks work? Well, the good news is that the Python documentation actually gives us kind of a reference implementation of what to do. All I did was take the function in the docs and change some of the types here and there. For the forward pass, we check to see if the other argument has a type that we specifically support. In our case, that's any other exact rational number or another complex fraction. Otherwise, we check to see if we should fall back to floating point arithmetic. The way that Python lets you signal to let the other argument try its reverse method is by returning not implemented, or if this function wasn't defined at all. The integers dunder add would return not implemented to allow our complex fractions rAdd to be called. Instead of ab, we use ba in the reverse version. This is so we can keep the logic mostly the same but still end up with swapped arguments. Once again, we check for things that we specifically support. Otherwise, we check if the other thing is a complex number, and fall back to floating point in that case. Notice, however, that these cases are not exactly the same, though. Here, we're checking against specific types, float and complex, whereas here, we're checking with the abstract interface, complex. In the forward pass, we don't want to check against an abstract interface here, because that would be a little bit too eager. We wouldn't want to immediately fall back to floating point arithmetic if B happened to implement the complex interface. For all we know, B is another kind of exact complex number type that knows about our complex number type. So we would want to give that type a chance to do its reverse operation. We only fall back in the forward pass if we're sure there's nothing more intelligent we can do. I really encourage just reading the documentation here. I don't think explaining it in a video is the right way to catch all the subtleties. But in any case, we define the forward and reverse versions of our operations and then return them. Now we understand why it's written this way. We factored out the functionality of all the cases that we know how to add into this function, otherwise fall back to the default operation after converting to a floating point number. Repeat for subtraction, multiplication, and division. Unfortunately, we have to write exponentiation for ourselves, both forward and reverse. This is because, unlike with addition, multiplication, subtraction, and division, a complex fraction to the power of a complex fraction is not necessarily another complex fraction. So we basically just fall back to floating point arithmetic unless we have an integer exponent. Handle the case of 0 separately. If our exponent was negative, then do 1 over the absolute value. And if we got a positive integer, then use FastPow. I just made a video on FastPow, so if you want to hear more about it, check it out, but suffice it to say that it works with complex numbers. For the reverse version, we're raising some base to the power of ourselves, which is a complex number. So we're pretty much always going to have to fall back to floating point arithmetic in that case. We do make one special exception where if we happen to be purely real, the built-in fraction class that is our real part might have something more sensible to do, although honestly probably not. Positive and negative are pretty self-explanatory. For absolute value, we separate out the case where we're purely real or purely imaginary. In that case, we can give an exact answer. Otherwise, we do square root of a squared plus b squared. The a squared plus b squared part is this norm squared. This isn't required by the complex interface, but oftentimes you can use the norm squared instead of using the absolute value. If so, that's a big win because the norm squared is always going to be an exact infinite precision fraction, whereas the absolute value typically is not because of the square root. Then we come down to conjugate. This is required by the interface, and it's fairly straightforward. Just flip the sign of the imaginary part. Then we come to probably the most subtle and confusing part, the hash function. The first time I implemented this class, I didn't realize how subtle this was. I thought, okay, I need a hash function. Why don't I just take the hash of the pair of the real and imaginary parts? Simple enough, right? Well, that's no good. The reason that's no good is that I want my complex fraction to work like all the other number types. In particular, complex fraction 0 should be equal to 0, it should be equal to 0.0, it should be equal to the fraction 0, and it should be equal to the complex 0. Zeros of all the other types compare equal to the integer 0. And more generally, whenever two numbers of different types represent the same theoretical value, they still compare equal. Although due to rounding errors, of course, it doesn't always work out the way that we might think based off of the notation. Okay, so this might complicate our equality function, but what does this have to do with the hash? In order for sets and dictionaries to work, equal values must have equal hashes. That means that if I want my complex fraction to compare equal to other numbers, it needs to have the same hash as those numbers if they represent the same value. Whether it's 0, float 0, complex 0, or complex fraction 0, they all need to have the same hash, the hash of 0. Checking equality is very simple. If I see something else implementing the complex interface, then I just compare real and imaginary parts. But how do you come up with this hash function? Well, once again, it's read the documentation to the rescue. I don't have to come up with my own hash function. The documentation essentially says, if you're implementing a complex number type, use this hash function. I didn't come up with it, I'm just using the one that I found in the docs. At first, I didn't even realize there was an issue, then I thought it was a huge issue, and then the docs just gave me the answer. It was kind of a roller coaster ride to go on, but I'm glad to know that it's been sorted out. Moving on, we finish up with the Boolean conversion operator, reduce copy, and deep copy. We actually didn't need to implement this one, it's actually included in our base class. Remember, 0 is false, non-zero values are true. Reduce is for pickling. For reduce, we return two things. The first is a callable that we'll use to reconstruct the object when we unpickle, and the second is the state. So we essentially pickle the real and imaginary parts separately, and then reconstruct it by passing it to the class to create a new instance. Copy and deep copy are kind of interesting, since they just return self. Remember, our class is immutable. So how do we make a copy of something immutable? There's no need to actually make a copy because we're immutable. So we just return ourselves. We do need to be careful though. If someone subclasses our class, they might not want it to be immutable anymore. So if the type isn't exactly complex fraction, then we should just pass the real and imaginary parts and try to construct a new one. Same thing for deep copy. Our real and imaginary parts are themselves both fractions which are immutable. So there's nothing to deep copy and we just return self. And with all that, we now have our own infinite precision complex fraction type. Of course, don't forget to write tests. Lots and lots of tests. Especially involving the hashes and make sure the dictionaries work properly. I also wanted to point out one thing that I didn't talk about, and that's comparisons. Complex numbers don't have a natural order to them, so I didn't define any of the less than or equal to, greater than or equal to methods. Since they weren't defined, we'll just get type errors. But if you were modeling a subset of the real numbers, you probably would want to define them. If you like my content, then you're also going to love this video's sponsor, Brilliant.org. Brilliant is the leader in terms of curated, interactive math, science, and computer science lessons. If you're anything like me, then you like to learn something new every single day. And Brilliant is the perfect place to do that since they have thousands of high-quality lessons with more coming every month. You can even find courses on Python, computer science, and machine learning to supplement what you learn on this channel. So, if you'd like to get started for free, visit brilliant.org/mcoding or click the link in the description and sign up today. The first 200 of you will get 20% off Brilliant's annual premium subscription. As always, thank you to my patrons and donors. Don't forget to subscribe.